you know, they pick them up, they take them out.
Wow.
Okay, good evening. Welcome to the January 12th meeting of the Northampton Planning Commission, Planning Board, I guess it is. We generally start each meeting with an opportunity for public comment. I don't see any additional public here tonight, but Wayne, do you have any public comment that you want to make? What's first on the agenda tonight is a review and adoption, optimistic of you, Wayne, of Walk Bike Northampton Plan, a comprehensive bike and pedestrian plan. It is, the floor is yours.
Okay. So I know some.
Before you start, can I just ask?
Of course.
Just for context. So it says adoption. Are we actually the the terminal body which adopts it, or is it goes from us to somebody else?
So you're the body who legally has to adopt it. So comprehensive plans, that is the part of the comprehensive plans, are by law adopted by the planning board. By practice, because not everybody listens to you, we go to multiple bodies. So we're beyond transportation and parking and probably city council as well. But you're sort of the legal one that makes it part of the plan. And that does a has only one legal effect, which is, you remember when you do site plan approvals and special permits, one of the criteria is compliance with the city's comprehensive plan. So other than that, it's mostly symbolic and it helps us a lot. I'm gonna go through some examples, but that's the one place where it has legal effect. Some of you like to read online, some like paper. So I just printed the executive summary, and then I printed three copies of the full thing for
one.
You guys can share. We can print more. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and I've got one, so. Okay.
You got it.
It is. Yes. Right. So I'm going to walk you through this, but you know, interrupt as we go along. Most of this is about the plan, but I wanted to set a little bit of context. So, planning department has always been involved with transportation planning, but we really stepped up our role in it dramatically in 2008 when you did Sustainable Northampton, or you or your predecessors did Sustainable Northampton. Until then, it was sort of, planning had been a little bit ad hoc. We didn't have a clear set of policies. And the 2008 plan created a clear set of policies, you know, a complete streets policy and sort of a lot of guidance. And that really sort of helped, you know, again, make it more rigorous, our approach. It's not that we weren't looking at projects before. And so if you remember, if any of you were here in 2008, we had that policy, and then probably most of you were here last year, about a year and a half ago, when we changed our policy into a city ordinance. And in some ways, frankly, we actually weakened it. Because in 2008, we said, we want bike and pedestrian access everywhere, every time. And when we made an ordinance, we said, well, we get that Audubon Road's probably never going to have a sidewalk. And so we were a little more realistic in pulling it back. And actually, the state does a scoring system of complete streets policies. And so we lost points in our new policy, but I think it's more honest. And DPA was actually following it, whereas before they weren't always following it. Now they're taking it very seriously. So they're important. I just want to start with one example of sort of how this stuff counts. So you all think, because sometimes you see here during the, you're involved with the planning process, and then you're involved with permitting, and you don't always see what else comes out of the planning process. So you probably have all read, we have $2.9 million in grants to spend on Pleasant Street in the next 11 and a half months. And that comes really pretty directly out of the Sustainable Northampton plan and the vision that it created, as well as a lot of strategic things, but the big vision came out of that. Of that 2.9 million, roughly half of it is for complete streets work on Pleasant Street. So adding sidewalks where sidewalks are in bad shape, closing curbs where there used to be auto-oriented businesses that were constantly crossing, adding a cycle track, basically a buffered bike lane or a grade separated bike lane between Holyoke and Hockerman, adding raised intersections at raised crosswalks at two spots, and then adding a raised intersection, which is basically, think a raised crosswalk, but 40 feet long at one intersection, and doing curb extensions at three locations. So a lot of different stuff along the way. doing some street trees, doing rain gardens in two or three locations, taking stormwater off the road and putting them either directly into the trees or into a rain garden on the site, so that when it rains, there's less flooding. We're sending less water down to be pumped, you know, over mm-hmm. the sewage treatment plant. So all sorts of good things. The other, again, roughly half the money is going for paying for a single replacement of 150-year-old brick storm sewer that goes to the lumberyard property. The lumberyard is the biggest single property on Pleasant Street, and it really couldn't have been developed without the project going forward. So we got this grant about a month ago, and then 2 days ago, the state announced the grant to Valley CDC, and that's the two are tied together. They couldn't go forward with the funding. So all this is saying, you guys do the planning, but it really goes somewhere afterwards, even when you're not involved incredibly in the details for doing it. So I think I've gone over most of these, but just quickly in terms of seeing the different things that come out of your past planning efforts. So there's five things we've been working on Pleasant Street. You've been involved with the majority of them, but not all of them. So we've slowly been expanding the commercial uses and mixed uses. So it used to be the Central Business District ended the bike path. You expanded down to Holyoke Street in the not too distant past. I mean, my life, 10 years is not too distant. And we're looking at further intensifications, probably going to suggest expanding Central Business District up to Hockman Road. And that will come back to you, but just that sort of intensification, creating more space for things to happen on Pleasant Street. Then the roundabout, obviously, is almost done. That started from a study the city did, I guess, about a decade ago now. Where it was a high crash intersection, we got the state on board. We've wanted to take over Pleasant Street from MassDOT for a number of years because we can do on-street parking, we can convert it from a highway to a street. But so the roundabout was really important for us, but MassDOT also liked the idea of dropping the ownership of Pleasant Street. So we worked out a deal, this is from the last mayor, where we would take over the street if they would build a roundabout. And so they spent couple of $1,000 in design and about $2 million in construction. Usually what happens for a city street is we would have been responsible for design and layout. So the construction wasn't really a coup. They would have done that eventually anyway. But the design, getting it off our books and onto their books, was a big deal. And that's important, you know, besides being sort of the entry to downtown. You know, we don't ever anticipate Pleasant Street's going to be like Main Street in terms of that kind of commercial. But we think there's a lot of room for infill. I'll pick on you, which is, you know, Beehive Sewing probably couldn't afford Main Street rents. Pleasant Street's never going to be an attractive place for some of the businesses on Main Street, but we want to create more spaces for more Beehive Sewing, that kind of thing. You know, there's often a debate, and you all hear some of this, whenever a Starbucks opens or Dunkin' Donuts opens, people say, oh, this is horrible. Northampton's going to the devil because all these chains are coming in. And I think staff's approach, which has been supported by the board in the past, has been we can embrace it, we can take everything, we just need to make sure we're leaving a space that's $15 or $20 a foot. So some spaces are $40 a foot, and that's okay as long as we have enough spaces for our local businesses. So Pleasant Street's part of that formula going forward. The brick sewer I talked about, replacing the brick sewer, which allows the lumberyard to go forward. All the pedestrian and bicycle improvements I talked about already, that's the other $1.5 million from the Streets and MassWorks grant. The Gateway Art, this is smaller, but two parts of this project. One was driven by neighborhood associations. If you go by Lamprin Park, which is the park in front of Bridge Street School, there's a gateway sign that's there. Jerry Budger and some other people from the neighborhood association did the fundraising for it. The city did the contracting. We're planning to put another one of those, slightly different, but the same concept, at the intersection of Hockman Road and Pleasant Street. Again, as a sort of a sense of arrival. And eventually, we still have to do fundraising, eventually on Route 10 coming to town as well. So that sort of, again, you know, what's the sense of place as you come in? We have a consultant right now that's looking at all of downtown for wayfinding signage. It's again about creating a sense of place and for visitors who we don't expect to walk downtown, but we'd like to encourage visitors to park once and then walk. So if you park in the parking garage, you may find out where the post office isn't very far. You don't really need to get back in your car and drive in there. And then the last project, which Carolyn's shepherding, is looking at the roundabout, and the center of the roundabout is trying to do an art installation there. And that's both as a sense of arrival when you get here, but also it actually gets people to drive slower. We want people to have enough visibility that they see what they need to see, but not so much visibility that they see more than they need to see and think they can go faster. And then obviously those two projects under construction, well, the HAP housing project under construction now, and the Valley CDC project, a lot of city money in both projects from both block grant and CPA, but I think, you know, really pay off a long way. So all that sort of came out of the past efforts. That's my background. So the Walk Bike Northampton project really has four different, you can divide it up in different ways, but it's four different pieces. So the main parts of the plan, that's what we're gonna spend most of the time, that's what I'm asking you to adopt on either tonight or your next meeting. But the two other pieces, one is, this is a regional grant. So we got $109,000 that's paid for this plan. We got that by virtue of being the lead community for a 15-town effort to bring health into thinking about our built environment. Wonderful grant, we're getting $400,000 a year for things throughout the region. We said we'd be willing to administer, which takes a fair amount of staff time, and our cost, as it were, was that we get the walk bike plan paid for. So we didn't sneak it through, we were very honest, that was our cost for sponsoring. They also paid direct time involved as well. But it's a regional grant, so we did a few other things. So the Complete Streets Transect was looking throughout Hampshire County and thinking, in different places, what would an appropriate treatment be? You know, where are the places where sidewalks make sense? Where are the places where side trails along a road make sense? So you can just imagine hundreds of different kinds of treatments. There's lots of great design. Boston has an amazing design manual, but we're not exactly like Boston. So we're trying to look at these design manuals that are out there, most of which are more urban, and seeing how they apply to places like us. Federal Highway just released a similar one a couple days ago, and our consultant did that project, was the lead author for that project. So you're going to see a look and feel of both of them because they stole from each other. But I think that helps. One of the reasons that's important going forward is we've looked at revisiting our zoning and thinking about how can we make the zoning friendlier and easier to read, more graphic oriented. And part of that is about coding the public realm. So you all know from the permits that when someone comes in for a permit, in most areas, the street itself is the city's. But we expect people to fix the public realm, the public ownership, from the edge of a property up to the curb line. You know, new sidewalks, new street trees, whatever it is, they're different for each project. And so you guys discuss those as part of site plan. But you really do it on an ad hoc basis. We don't really have a clear set of standards. And particularly when the standards are sometimes in conflict. So for Shaw's Motel, you know, the standard we often use is we'd like our sidewalks to be 6 feet wide in mixed-use areas. We'd like our tree belts to be 6 feet wide in mixed-use areas. But it's not 12 feet between the Shaw's property and the street. So how do you, you know, do those things? We'd like to put that in zoning, but this Complete Streets Transect will help create the conversation. Again, it's a first step. We'll be coming back to that. The annex is really just sort of technical things. And then one of the things I do want to spend a little bit of time on is Main Street itself. So we spent a lot of time looking at Main Street and thinking, does Main Street work? Where does it not work? We're in the queue. It's a very long queue for federal funds and state funds to redo all of Main Street. So that's probably a dozen years down the line. But you know, we started Pleasant Street a dozen years ago, and so we're moving forward. So again, the design manual, I didn't print this out for you. It's on our website. If anybody wants to see it, it's fine. Again, I think this manual is probably less useful for you in your day-to-day work, but I'm sure we're going to use pieces of it when we come back to talk about future zoning changes. And then the annex, again, it's fairly technical. Probably you don't need it unless something else is referring you to it. So this piece is about Belchertown streets, because this is a regional grant. The stuff at Main Street I'm going to talk about in a second has budget items because we applied to begin the process for getting our federal funds. So most of it's not that relevant to you, although we can certainly spend time on it later. So I want to talk a little bit about Main Street, just about 2 or 3 minutes, and then spend the rest of the time on the plan itself. But just some quick history again, because you have different lengths of years in the planning board. So we began the process, we hired Nelson Nygaard 6 years ago-ish. And we asked them to look at both Main Street and King Street. And we said, do these things have to be four lanes? We had hired VHB about 12 years ago, and VHB said, oh, King Street needs to be four lanes. And Carolyn wouldn't believe it. And she said, we have to re-examine that. Because the technology's been changing. We used to hear you need to be four lanes if you're 9,000 cars a day or more. And then we start hearing people say, well, it's 12,000, 15, 17. Now you see some places that 20,000 cars a day and are going to one lane each direction. So we need to look at it. The study said that, yes, King Street could certainly be narrower, at least up to the bike path and probably beyond. We've reached an internal consensus in the city that up to the bike path, where the bike path crosses by Stop and Shop, is going to go to one lane. So right now it's one lane up to North Street, then it slowly widens to two lanes in each direction. That's going to go back to one lane, but with turn pockets. So it's actually, you know, cars weave all the time, and that could be inefficient. So with turning lanes and turn pockets, in some cases, the cross-section will still be four lanes. But the through lanes will be one lane each direction. We've hired Fussin O'Neill. That's under design. That's currently programmed for construction in 2019. So that's going to be a big change.
So it'll go from North Street to the bike path?
Exactly. Yeah. It's going to start now. You know, the last bit up to the bike path is really just line painting. Mm-hmm. So most of the construction is up to Florence Savings Bank, but the line painting goes up to the bike path.
Going to neck down the bike path on either side, any?
So the bike lanes basically end where the bike path crosses. So we send lanes up. At this point, we're still at early design at 20%. But at this point, northbound, it's going to be a cycle track separated from the road. Southbound, it's probably just going to be painted lines. I'm doing just in terms of where we have right of way. And then there's a very short section where the bike path currently follows the sidewalk. We're going to actually widen that to make that, and that's where we're basically going from the street, you know, up and sort of ending at that point over there. And King Street's really too narrow north of that to do it. So they looked at Main, they looked at King Street, but they also looked at Main Street. Main Street's more complicated than King Street. And so it's a slow process. We need to do a lot more. They basically were saying, hey, this seems to work. We run the quick numbers, but you have to spend a lot more time. So we then hired the same consultant to look at that compound intersection over here by Academy Music, Main, State, Elm, West, New South Street, to see, you know, how can we make that work? And they did. They got up to about 20% design and basically said, yes, we can narrow the road there. Again, just, you know, when you narrow roads, drop lanes, you don't want to drop the lanes going through the intersection. Because it's sort of the intersection where the light's green for 40% of the time. That's really what meters the traffic on the road. So you want to send a lot of cars through in as many lanes as possible through the signal. As soon as you get past the signal, there's lots of excess capacity in the road because it's determined by the next signal. So we'd still keep that wide, but there's ways we can play with it. So we have that turn lane, the fly lane, if you will, where you're going from South Street onto Main Street. And that mostly works. Cars don't always yield for pedestrians. But if you think about sort of the way a roundabout works, it's the same concept. You make cars turn sharply enough that they go slow and then they're willing to stop for pedestrians. So they came up with this concept basically doing the same thing on the southwest corner and maybe the same thing on the northwest corner. So you have some movements that can go even when the light's red, which lets the capacity work. And in return, you can narrow the profile of the road dramatically. So, sorry, I can't all say the same thing, but on this one, the stop line is really about 40 feet to the east. So that's a long way. Lights turn green, it takes a long time before cars actually make it into the intersection. And that means you have a 2-minute signal, you're wasting a lot of the time for doing it. So it makes this intersection work great. We started going forward. We actually have money to design this, the full 100%. We got it as an approved project from MassDOT, which just means we could start the process. And then we said it doesn't really make sense to work on that intersection without looking at all of Main Street. Because if we just look at the intersection, the sort of the vision for the rest of Main Street wouldn't make sense. And so we put that on hold, and as part of the walk bike plan, we decided to come back. This was not.
No, I was just going to put the pointer on for you.
Oh. So we started doing a series of things. We looked at when we hire an engineer, it's a lot of money. You're paying the engineers a lot of money to do the design. So it started this about cost savings. Rather than just going out and hiring an engineer, we tried to see how much stuff could we do inexpensively. So we took advantage of a few programs the state has for free. The first was basically a safety audit. We're required to do safety audits for intersections. And so we did the safety audit with Mass Bike and Walk Boston, MassDOT, and Tool, who's an engineer that MassDOT hired, to look at the opportunities on Main Street. Everything from long term, and they said absolutely think about narrowing the street, to shorter term, and this is where the Kirkland Avenue, the Cracker Barrel Alley project, which we've been talking about for a long time, but it's where it started moving ahead, because they said, yes, that makes sense. And then we did some other things that I don't have any slides for yet. MassDOT is working on what they're calling a transit enhancement study. on looking at improved transit between Northampton and Amherst, and they're looking at downtown as part of it. But there was a lot of effort on the ALTA design, the plan that you have, I'm asking you to adopt. There was a lot of effort taking this to the next step. So they looked at a lot of alternatives. Again, they haven't yet run the $40,000 models. We're going to have to run later to go to full design. So we're not in any way representing that this is what's going forward. We're calling this option one, I think. So it's you know, we're going to hire an engineer and say, look at this option, tell us if it works or doesn't work, and what do we need to do? We know, for example, that to do this intersection, we would need a waiver from MassDOT because about 3% of the traffic is 69-foot tractor trailers turning left from Main Street onto New South Street. And though tiny bit of traffic, maybe it's not even 2%, that tiny bit of traffic would not work with this. Every other traffic movement works. So whether MassDOT's willing to accept that or not, we don't know. When we met with MassDOT to go through this, that was their only sort of potential no-go. Everything else was, we're fine with this if the numbers work, if the models come through. So the idea, again, you can't really see unless I zoom this in, but the idea would be one lane each direction. One of the things we want to do is lose as little parking as possible downtown, because the parking downtown is the most important parking. On Main Street is the most important parking. We have to lose two or three, a few spots, but not a lot. Adding cycle tracks, so basically there'd be the curb, then a bicycle lane, then the parked cars. So it's safer to bicycle through downtown. And then adding turn pockets. So we're really just, in essence, freeing up one lane. You know, we're taking off 12 feet of real estate. Because what's more important is having turn pockets. You know, a car, when you get to Academy of Music, we want a building just like there is now, a building for cars to turn left and a building for cars to turn right. When you get to Masonic Street, we want cars to turn left into Masonic and not make the other cars queue back all the way. But at least those turn pockets keep changing. Sometimes when you go by Crafts Avenue, the turn pockets for making a left turn westbound. Sometimes when you go by, you know, Center Street, it's on the left side again going eastbound. Mm-hmm. So that's sort of what the show is here, and lots of things have to be worked out, but this becomes the main piece.
Is that big complicated intersection, the one, I don't know how we refer to it at the Academy of Music, is that regarded as being very problematic? I don't walk across it, but it's driving a car, it seems like a piece of cake.
It has a fairly high crash rate. So there's one story of crashes I should mention. So until 2009, when you looked at both the state and our regional planning council do reports on high crash intersections. And we all said, none downtown. We're very proud. We have some at Damon Road, and we have some at Cons and Pleasant. None downtown, and we held our head high in the air. And then MassDOT changed the way they count intersections. They said, we have two different things. We're going to look at high crash intersections, and we're going to look at clusters. And clusters are areas which are together like downtowns. And we became the sixth highest crash cluster in the entire Commonwealth. We've since dropped down to 11th highest. But
wait, what became that? That intersection?
No, when they looked at all the intersections together,
everything.
The story, they all fit together. So we have a fair amount of crashes. One of the things we don't yet have is Pioneer Valley Planning Commission is pulling all the crashes for the last 5 years. So we have a little more detail in the next month or so when that gets done. But the answer is there are a fair number of crashes at that intersection, all low speed and very rare no fatalities I'm aware of that intersection, but lots of fender benders. We did have a pedestrian fatality just south of there 2 years ago. And then as part of this whole piece, people are jostling for position, so some crashes that happen downstream are sometimes related to that intersection. So that's one challenge. The other challenge is when you look at pedestrians crossing the road, when pedestrians jaywalk, it's, you know, we like to say they're not following the rules and they're not good law-abiding people, but it's also sort of an indictment of the road itself. That if you make people wait too long, there's something wrong with the road. So if any of you go to Manhattan and walk down the street, the total signal cycle at most Manhattan intersections, other than a few major cross streets, is usually about a minute. And that's a good amount. People are willing to wait that long. That signal is somewhere around 2 minutes. I'm not exactly sure how long it is. And so that means everybody gets frustrated. You can see it go there any time, maybe not now, but certainly any time during the day. And the number of cars who go through when it's a yellow light or when it's the first few seconds of red is pretty astonishing. And that's a that's a symptom of an intersection and making people wait too long. And then pedestrians do exactly the same thing. People cross when they shouldn't cross.
Isn't that to some extent, I mean, I don't know, a function of how many intersecting streets there are? I mean, it seems like it probably inevitable given that fact.
Well, we think you can make it much tighter and solve the problem. So about 12 years ago, 15 years ago, when George Andrikides was here, he said, I'm not going to solve this. We're going to have a right turn, no right turn in red, right? You all know how no right turns in a red work. But we know that intersection doesn't work well, so we're going to have a no right turn in red that's only on in some phases. So we bought this fancy device, spent $10,000 on it, and it said no right turn in red, but it only went on in certain phases. The day it went on, the cars queued back so far they had to turn off. So it's still up there. If you go look at the light, you see right in the post, you see this weird thing like, why is there a sign posted here? Well, behind it is an electronic sign that says no right turn in red, but it only turns red sometimes. So, you know, because these two intersections work together, you know, I now live at the State Hospital, and often I can't get out of West Street because cars are queued back so far. So then people take risks, and so that's actually a very high crash intersection. So not the first part by Academy Music, but the next one up, right. And it's related to people's frustration going through. The MassDOT adjusted the signal timing by just a few seconds, and it created all, you know, so it's a signal that's sort of on the edge of total failure. And it works, but just barely. And frankly, in terms of intersections, this is actually a fairly inexpensive change. So when you think about the roundabout at exit 19 or the roundabout by the co-op, those are both $2.5 million projects. This is $1 million. Now, it's not that $1 million isn't anything, but it's nothing compared to sort of a lot of intersections there.
I'm sorry, Mark, did you have a
go ahead.
I'm sorry, did you say that you live at Hospital Hill and sometimes traffic is backed up all the way there?
No.
Oh, okay.
It's backed up to Forbes Library, but it can't get in.
Oh, I see. Oh, right. Yeah. Okay.
Right.
Yeah. Okay.
You know, the thing, you're not supposed to block the intersection, but everybody does.
Right.
You know, because they're all tied together. That's what makes this one so difficult is the number of things that come together. But.
So I don't know if it was in that same report, Nelson Nygaard, is it? 6-7 years ago. But on Main Street, I saw plans for the sidewalks being extended, so the restaurants can, you know, people, pedestrian and sidewalks and eating outside, great. And I saw another version of an island right down the middle to make the crosswalk shorter and planting trees and little mini parks down, that looked great. Is this the result of all those different options? This is the favored approach?
Yes. Okay. Now, again, just to be clear, because this is still a 1,000-foot up level, so there's some detailed discussion. So we looked in detail at sidewalk. For the most part, we don't think we need wider sidewalk. There's some exceptions. The diagnosis that I use is just during sidewalk sale days, where is it the DNA decided they need to take over some of the street? So right across from City Hall, it's fairly narrow. So sometimes they take over the street. So it may be one or two spots where we want to steal 5 feet, and that place actually is very wide. But yes, for the most part, the feeling was we had enough. And then the islands, likewise, it used up a lot of real estate with limited benefits. They are basically looking at what's called pedestrian refuge islands, so not an island the entire distance, which also makes snow plowing difficult. But some of the islands right now, like by TD Bank, have a, you know, a 2-foot island right there. Mm-hmm. We probably would do that at each crosswalk. But otherwise, and then MassDOT's now require, MassDOT's really gotten religion about bike facilities, so they're requiring bike lanes. This one showing it between the parked cars and the curb.
And is there a curb between the bike lane and the parked cars, or no, it's just a painted line?
Again, that could be changed later. The current concept, there is a curb that's there. But that, again, they didn't go in that level. They showed a cross-section. I actually showed cross-sections both ways. That's what's on the bottom here, but my eyes aren't good enough to actually read those sketches. But if you zoomed in, it's, you know, I think
what's
the
net effect on parking?
So in terms of the general street, no net effect. In theory, we're not losing any parking spots. The biggest challenge is actually about truck loading and unloading. As a practical matter, trucks load, they take over the set. They used to take over spots, and the meter people said, we don't want that. So now, even though it's technically legal, they direct trucks to park in the middle of the street. That wouldn't work with this. So we'd have to carve out spots, and it might be at each intersection street. So at Crafts Avenue, it might be a truck loading zone, at each one of those things. And that's going to use up some parking spots. So that's not shown here.
Just putting on my Joe Citizen hat. So I'm a resident of Northampton. You're telling me, Mr. City, you're going to do all this work and there's not going to be any additional parking?
There's no additional parking.
Right.
going to be less parking and less lanes.
But that's also separate from the conversation of doing, I mean, even if you were to add parking, it would be one or two spots. Right. That's separate from the conversation of doing a whole parking garage somewhere. Right. Down.
Right. We can't.
It's just such an issue. I just can envision, you know.
I mean, we can't really do parking close. Places that are no parking zones now wouldn't be safe to add parking. In some ways, we actually need to drop a few spots to create more visible buffers. So the only real place we could have done something is between City Hall and the Academy of Music, where we have parallel parking. We could have taken over that extra real estate and put an angle parking on one side. It wouldn't have created that many spots, and then the entire bike lane wouldn't have been possible through there. So that was really the one trade-off, and it wasn't that much. We are looking everywhere we can in other places. So this isn't a lot. I think it's one, maybe it's one, maybe it's even two spots. But for a short while, we had a bus that stopped on Old South Street. And it's marked no parking. We're adding one or two spots there. So we're looking at those little places around town for doing it. That wayfinding effort I mentioned before, part of that wayfinding is to improve signage to help people get to the side streets, you know, to the side parking lots.
This may be off topic, but you mentioned a roundabout at exit 19. Is that really going to happen?
Yeah, that's moving forward. MassDOT said they had a 25% public hearing.
To me, that just seems like a horrendous idea. It's a different conversation. Yeah. Mm. Maybe I'll stop by your office and bend your ear sometime, because I think that's just not only a waste of money, but make it worse.
Well, from a traffic flow standpoint, it actually should work. They can carry a lot more volume.
But it works
traffic.
Now.
What's that?
It works now.
My wife, who does that commute every day, would tend to disagree.
Right. I mean, there's other
Damon Road
light on Damon Road by the in front of the old car dealer there. That's where
by the industrial park.
Yeah, just past the industrial by the entrance to the industrial.
So there's a separate plan that's also moving forward on about the same time period. For adding right turn lanes. So MassDOT did a bunch of changes recently to King and Damon. But what they didn't do, because we have to tear down two houses to do it, is add a right turn lane on Damon. And that right turn lane is really important because there's not enough lanes there.
Right.
So again, you know, where I'm someone who always want to drop lanes, I don't want to drop them in intersections. So having a right turn lane there means cars won't queue back so far on Damon Road.
But coming off the bridge up Damon Road, there's the traffic light before the entrance to the industrial park, that where there's half a mile backup of cars all the time.
Yeah.
It just seems, well, there's no traffic going in and out of the industrial park.
Yeah.
Doesn't
so that's not
seem
about
to
the
make
industrial
any
park.
Sense.
That's about MassDOT is so petrified. They don't generally like at-grade crossings for railroads. They're so petrified that a car is going to be on the railroad because people are stupid. People will drive right in the tracks even when they can't get off the tracks for a red light, and they're so petrified someone's going to kill them and derail Amtrak that they use that not to let the industrial drive work, but to meter traffic through. So the more that we get, that's the reason those right turn lanes become important. If we get cars through there sooner, then they'll release some of that metering in industrial drive.
Well, but you can't even get up to the tracks because the line of cars stopping at the traffic light is so long. I mean, that.
Yeah, I know. Right.
You probably know this perfectly well. Sometimes it goes all the way back to the bridge.
Yeah, absolutely. And that's the only intersection in town, the only road in town, where I think we really have a morning rush hour. So we have an afternoon rush hour in lots of places. Damon Road's particularly bad. But Damon Road's also almost as bad in the morning. And that's not, you know, downtown's easy going through in the morning. Lots of places are easy going through. So, you know, that whole street needs to be looked at.
So that is being looked at?
Yeah, so it's two separate projects, the roundabouts on one time period, and then the rest of the street is on the other. But and the public hearing on the roundabout was held about 6 months ago. The public hearing on the rest of Damon Road is supposed to be sometime late winter. We don't have a date yet for that piece. All right, so the other thing we asked them to do as part of this process is we did the complete streets demonstration. Some of you took part in that. I'm not going to make you listen to this whole video, plus I'm not sure I can even get it to work. But if you came to our, I guess, So if you came to our event at APE, you saw this. Maybe you're not going to see this now. Did you all see the Complete Streets video that we did?
Oh, you know why you're not going to get on?
Why?
It's that double Wi-Fi thing.
No, it's right here. I copied it on the...
Oh, you did? Okay. Hmm. You copied it onto the computer?
Yeah. Okay. Right. It's not important, but, you know, so one of the things we did...
So it's looking for the old address, not the new one.
We did a couple things as part of the Alta project, the same plan. We did a Complete Streets demonstration where we both demonstrated what worked and what didn't work, and we also tested some concepts. So, like, early in the morning, we were not aggressive enough about... So we dropped one lane each direction and created, you know, bike lanes and created a parklet. Early in the morning, we said, well, let's not be too aggressive. And so we didn't narrow the lane enough, and we actually had one near collision because we weren't aggressive enough. Because people thought, oh, I could slip through there right next to the other car, or the other car is going to yield. And so we actually got more aggressive, and we moved the barrels another 4 feet. Mm-hmm. So that was like at 9 o'clock in the morning, and the rest of the day, everything went smoothly. So, you know, it helped us in terms of this process going forward. It also helped, frankly, build, you know, political support. DPW loved it. The mayor loved it in the process. I hope we do more of these demonstrations. Some things we have to design and build, but whenever we can test it first, we'd like to test it going forward in the process. But the other thing we did is, with his health grant, we've bought some equipment. So we bought some pedestrian counters and some bicycle counters and some time-lapse photography. And one of the things we did is we just ran for 24 hours a camera from the second floor of City Hall on this crosswalk. Random 24 hours and looked at all the close calls. This goes back to what Alan was saying. There are a lot of close calls. You know, there's one place where a police officer didn't yield to a car in the crosswalks. Lots of other people don't yield.
Pedestrian.
What's that?
A pedestrian.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Sorry. You know, it was really interesting to see that in terms of where this are. And then we did the same thing of the number of cars and pedestrians entering Cracker Barrel Alley. You know, where were the clear conflict points? And so some of this is to give us real information, and some is just, frankly, to build the case, to do a day in the life of a thing that's chosen totally randomly and seeing what's out there. And so I think we're hopefully do more of that and some of those things you'll see forward. So then the rest is the plan itself, and all I have here, so this is what you have in front of you. So you see the table of contents. If you don't have the full plan, so you can see everything else that's in the plan. I'm just going to go through the executive summary. But I just wanted to tell you how we asked them to write the plan. So Sustainable Northampton, you all adopted in 2008. And our current vision is we really should come back in 2018 and revise the plan. We naively thought we could do it in 5 years after the plan happened, and that never happened, and that was probably unrealistic. But 10 years is really a good time to come back and do the plan. So we did the STAR Communities Assessment that some of you saw before and sort of, you know, a self-assessment on what's sustainable, what isn't in Northampton. And one thing we concluded in that process is there are really just two weaknesses in the Sustainable Northampton plan. One was bike and ped, and that's what led to this whole thing. And one was climate adaptation, and that's what the next thing on our list. So the goal is when we come back in 2018, we do a huge community process. We may get lots of new ideas, but at least you have a fairly good plan. The 10-year-old, 9-year-old plan is still pretty good, and you'd have these other documents to draw on. So the idea is instead of spending $105,000 for the last time for a consultant, we should be able to do the plan in-house. So we're sort of, you know, parceling out the pieces we can't necessarily do, and then we'll come back together. One of the things that's important to me, besides saving money, is when citizens get involved in the planning process, it takes 2 years, which is not uncommon for a comprehensive planning process, they lose interest, right? They can't really follow. And you get a few people who don't have a life, and they come to every single meeting, and they think they get to say the same thing 20 times, and they count more than 20 times as much as the person doesn't show up. So I wanted as much background material, so we have a few meetings, but they really count for something. So what we asked them to do is write the executive summary as if we were going to cut it and paste it into the comprehensive plan. And then the rest of it would always be an annex. And again, it doesn't mean you won't change every word in it, but at least that was their assignment, to tell a story in 10 pages. So even though it's a 160-page document, you're welcome to read the whole thing, 10 pages is really the most important part of the story. Some things that aren't in here just so you know, is they gave a deep, they spent a lot of time, because we had a lot of public meetings and workshops, on identifying every intersection in town that needs work to make it safer for bike and ped. That was important because the state then announced this $400,000 for complete streets money. And what they said is, we assume that most communities would take $50,000 we're giving to do a transition plan in the first year, and then a year later we'll apply for complete streets money, and of course it's going to be competitive. We took this plan, all the work they did, and we skipped, we didn't ask the Commonwealth for $50,000. No thanks. We did the transition plan in-house because we had this plan in front of us, and then that meant we applied for complete streets money. That's where we have for Pleasant Street, when nobody else applied. So in District 2, which is basically Springfield to Greenfield, we were the only application this year, so not surprising we got funded. So this plan was really, basically, it brought in $400,000 for us. Now, maybe we would have gotten it next year, but maybe not, because we're working on it. So let me just walk you through this. And again, I'm not going to spend every word to really give you an idea. But so just in terms of terms, so goals are the things which we all like. They're like mother and apple pie. We don't think people should get killed at intersections. It's hard to disagree. Objectives are the next step down. Right? Does this really mean that we're going to, you know, favor pedestrians and make cars suffer? You know, and so how do we measure some of those things? And then strategies are some of the things we're actually going to do, you know, which are overall strategy. So it might be, you know, a little deeper, and the actions are sort of the immediate thing. We're going to add curb extensions on Pleasant Street. So actions are very much in the weeds. The actions are not summarized in this executive summary. That's a lot of what the next 150 pages is about. This map is just, you see this map in a lot more detail in the next 150 pages, but they just sort of identified what are the most problematic intersections all over the town. They had two charges, which I think they did a good job of balancing. One is, we wanted them to be really responsive to what they heard from the community. And so when people came, we made sure that was reflected. But we also didn't want it to be a political process. You know, so we wanted to make sure that, you know, there are no sidewalks that serve River Run. Now, I don't think that's about racism, but I do think it's about River Run. People don't know how to come to city council meetings and complain enough to get sidewalks. And now we're finally doing sidewalks, so that we're going to solve that. But so we want to make sure we don't have those kinds of problems in the future. We looked at all those things.
What about sidewalks to River Valley Market or to Atwood?
So that's part of, one of the reasons that roundabout is so expensive up there is that's part of it. So MassDOT, at our request, but they did all the work, did sidewalks last year from Bridge Road up to Big Y. When we do the River Valley Market roundabout, it will go all the way down to their sidewalks and all the way back to Cook Avenue and all the way up to the food co-op sidewalks. So we'll tie them all together. It will have a crosswalk across the muffler shop or transmission shop on that side of the street, but we're not doing sidewalks. There's so few businesses on that side of the street.
Not doing sidewalks what?
On the east side of King Street.
Right.
You know, so you can do a crosswalk to the transmission shop, and if you want, this one business south, one business north, they would have sidewalks. But yeah, so that's part of it. We're doing some improvements. I think it's just an island by the co-op that's a really safe, really unsafe intersection coming out, so make that a little better. That's not our core part, so we're not fixing that totally. But yeah, the sidewalks are really important.
Atwood, the roundabout?
So that's MassDOT layout, right? MassDOT told us that they filed MEPA, which is the state environmental permitting, for that, which means it's early in their queue. It's not on any list for funding. So I don't know how many years down the line it is. I know for North King Street, that was about a six-year period from when they first told us they're going to do it to when it got built. So maybe it's still 6 years, but they're definitely planning on it. So the roundabout now extended the sidewalks up to Dyke Road, and the rest, yes, MassDOT has it on there. And yeah, so. And then the Damon Road project, incidentally, will have actually shared use paths. So from King Street to River Run will be just normal sidewalks. And from River Run all the way down to Bridge Street, it'll basically be a 10-foot or 12-foot wide mixed-use path that cyclists and walkers can do. So then, you know, so the goal of this thing is mom and apple pie, ensure the safe, efficient transportation of goods, people, by motor vehicles, bicycle, foot, and other means. Not really surprising, but I've been here long enough that I got here a year after King Street was rebuilt. And King Street was built without a single pedestrian actuated signal. So 30 years ago, we didn't say by all means, basically it's dead just by cars. And, you know, we would never do that again. We don't need to plan for that. But this sort of takes us a little deeper in the weeds. What are things we do? The plans are important. This is where you guys don't always get involved. Maybe we should report back more. But the plans are often sort of my office's charge. What are things we work on? So, you know, reduce use of single occupancy vehicles. This is not about saying that you shouldn't, you know, my wife commutes to work every day by single occupancy vehicles, and I do probably half the time. It's not saying people shouldn't be able to do that, but it's trying to provide alternatives for doing it. So we're working on bike share right now, and that partially comes out of these recommendations. So for people who don't want to do it, and a lot of millennials don't want to own a car, we're trying to give options in the process. So all those things, most of these objectives, we ask them to look at the existing plan. So if you, I'm not going to go through each one of these. If you went through these objectives, 80% of them, if you read our current plan, you've seen already. These aren't new. They're really just sort of drawing them out a little bit. Some are new, some are others. So number 9, for example, when we did the plan in 2008, MassDOT didn't have a design for separated bike lanes. Right? So they had bike lanes, a painted line, but they had nothing else. And then this concept called cycle tracks started circulating the literature. Cambridge was the first, as far as I know, the only community who really adopted cycle tracks. And then last year, just a year ago now, MassDOT adopted what they're calling buffered bike lanes. Buffered are things that are separate, either by grade separation or horizontal separation or cars. And so we no longer call them cycle tracks in the state. But so this is sort of, so that's that kind of subtle changes. Now there's a standard. We want to follow that standard in the process. And so we're going through some of these things. Some things like we wouldn't design Elm Street's bike lanes the same way if we'd done them over again because the standards change. They're fine. We're probably not going to redo it. So they go into some detail about that. So all those things, 1A through whatever the letters go to, they're spelling it out in some detail. And that's the stuff we didn't really have in the current plan. So the current comprehensive plan had an appendix. So we said, here's all the policies. That's in the plan. And then we attached an appendix. So it's basically for DPW to say, hey, for your next $500,000, here's our priorities. And our priorities were all about journey to schools. So we built sidewalks from Jackson Street, or filled the gap. Some was there already. But from Jackson Street to JFK, used to be sidewalks for only half of it. That came out of the process. We added sidewalks on North Hatfield. That came out of that process, a few other places that DPW prioritized. But they've now worked off that list that we did in 2008, so we're trying to replenish that list here for doing
Wayne,
it.
Wayne, just because it's across the street from my house, the Leonard Street, that was the curbing and making it so you had to actually, you couldn't just kind of,
right
and doing and making an actual, if I remember.
Turn, 90 degree.
Right.
So we've hired Time Bond to do that intersection. There's a little piece of land we want so we can move the street. We basically want to move the street down 10 feet. And the person who owns that house, that triangle, has agreed to sell it to us. So that design's underway. We don't need to have money to build it, but at least the design's going on that piece. Yeah, so a lot of these things are things that are already underway. Some of these were really new ideas for us. Some, frankly, gave us ammunition. So that complete streets thing I mentioned, we were required to be eligible to give a 5-year plan, as if they gave us $400,000 a year. They're not going to give us that money each year, but as if they gave it to us. So the first year is Pleasant Street. The second year is an off-ramp from the bike path at Edwards Square North Street and at Look Park by the northern Look Park entrance. The third year is Leonard Street. Those are partially based on priorities and partially based on readiness to go. The state money doesn't include design or construction oversight. So, for example, at the high school, that's a much more dangerous intersection. And if we were prioritizing based on danger, that crosswalk there, it'd be higher on our list. But we haven't even started collecting data. So even if someone gave us money, we wouldn't be ready to go. So even though, frankly, it's not as important as Leonard Street, it's in year 4, year 5 for that piece, to give us time to get there.
It's got to be like shovel ready.
That's right.
Yeah.
Right. Both shovel ready for design, and then even once you get the money for construction, we need someone who inspects the counts asphalt trucks
right.
that come in, and you know, planners do lots of things, but construction, I mean, I have no idea what a truck is, you know,
right.
so I need to hire someone to do that.
Right,
kind of thing.
Right.
Okay. And DPW does that themselves for Chapter 90 money, but they don't have enough extra capacity to do it for, you know, I bring extra money, they're incredibly supportive, but they don't have the staff to,
right.
to do that supervision. So again, all this list, so the second one, improve circulation to accommodate development and encourage bicycle and pedestrian transit. So that's important, again, because we wanted to send a message really clearly. We're not trying to stop any development. So the charge, for example, for this Academy Music intersection is we not necessarily making it better in terms of accommodating more cars, but we also want to make sure it's not worse either. We want to accommodate the same number of cars through there and also make it better for pedestrians going through. So again, a lot of these things you do already, subdivision standards, but there's some, I'm just trying to look offhand, there's some we don't have, you know, the closing the gaps on sidewalks, that was something we weren't so clear about last time, and one of the things that's come out of this already is we did this plan and then DPW with their funds immediately hired also the same firm we used to look at all the sidewalks in the city and figure out where there are gaps. So you may know it used to be many years ago, we repaved streets depending on which city councilor screamed the loudest. And then DPW did a pavement management system, where it's basically a triage. Which streets are so crummy, we shouldn't spend money until we're ready to rebuild it. Which streets can take a Band-Aid, which is really important, so we don't let it deteriorate, and which streets are in good shape. We've been doing that for, I don't know, 10, 15 years. Basically, DPW hired Alt to do the same thing for sidewalks. Some of you have seen a wheelchair going around town with a bunch of equipment that's actually not a person in the wheelchair, but the equipment's going around and it's measuring things. I don't know exactly what it's doing. But it's Georgia Tech's technology. They train local people to do the work for them. So we should be doing that. So that's coming out of this plan and the complete street.
Wayne, that's what I was just busy looking for. That's going to be the sidewalk conditions report, right?
Right. That's right. Right, and part of that is DPW wants to make sure that, you know, because one of the dangerous plans is we all say, this is great. We've all these places that don't have sidewalks that desperately need them. I agree Atwood Drive needs them. The food co-op needs them. But we have sidewalks that are sidewalks on paper only, you know. And so when we did the fields, Florence Fields, we put new sidewalks in there up to the Mill River. But the sidewalks between the Mill River and Florence Center on Meadow Street, they exist, but they do not meet anybody's standards whatsoever. They're 3 feet wide, and they're falling apart. And so they don't want to just build new stuff. They want to look at the existing stuff.
When you were doing the sort of leading indicators, when I see wheelchairs on the street, that's what it tells me.
Absolutely, yeah. So again, I'm not going through all these, but one thing we looked at is, in the process, the people who, you know, we had advocates from all groups coming. And so there's some advocates who think we should be incredibly friendly for bicycles in every street all the time. And so what you see, this is on 2F, for example, is we looked at how do we make sure you can get from point A to point B, no matter what kind of rider are you, but it doesn't mean that every street should be safe for you at every time. So on Pleasant Street, for example, we're putting in bike lanes, buffered bike lanes between Hockerman and Holyoke. At Holyoke Street, we're then slowing down the speed of traffic. We still want to allow the 10,000 cars a day that Pleasant Street gets, but we're slowing down the speed of traffic. That means that comfortable riders, and I'm vaguely comfortable, should be comfortable taking the street. Because at that point, it's only a few blocks, and I can keep up with cars, or almost, and they can wait behind me. And so comfortable riders should do that. Riders who aren't so comfortable, we think we should send them down to Holly Street, and we should make Holly Street really safe and really bicycle-friendly. As opposed to, we heard from some people who said, get rid of all the parked cars on Pleasant Street and put bike lanes in. It doesn't, we're trying to bring back businesses on Pleasant Street, that would bring businesses on Pleasant Street. So you see a few bike boulevards, and that's what they're all about. We looked at what are the places you know, coming down State Street to get to downtown, we want to make that more bicycle friendly. But when you get to Center Street, you should take Center Street and come to town that way. You shouldn't expect the rest of State Street to be bike friendly. Right. There's just not enough real estate. So those are the two ones we've identified so far, Pleasant Street north of Holyoke and State Street south of Center Street. There's been others as well, but the concept is you get everywhere in town, whatever kind of rider you are, but maybe you go out of your way a little bit. Otherwise, and then the alleyways, and we've talked about Crackerbar Alley. We have some discussions about Kirkland Avenue. Kirkland Avenue is a little more complicated because we don't own it. Crackerbar Alley is at least ours. So we have neighbors on Cracker Barrel who are unhappy about it because they're worried about noise. But that's really more of a political dimension, an important political dimension, but political nonetheless. Cracker Barrel requires a different kind of process. But sort of looking at all those things. Some of this is about shrinking distance. So we know if you ask people who park in the parking garage, what's the distance to Lower Main Street if you're going to a restaurant there? Some think it's a long distance because they're walking down Hampton Avenue, they're walking through Thorns. If they're comfortable going down Cracker Barrel Alley, that makes the effective distance shorter. And likewise, there's a couple of potential storefronts in Cracker Barrel Alley. You're never going to get CVS who wants a storefront like that. You're never going to get Starbucks. But you might get them, sorry to pick on you, but you might get them, you might get a local business there. So again, the transportation comes together for those kinds of things. I don't want to go over everything. Bicycle and vehicle parking, support local businesses. That one we'd drawn out before. We sort of had parking under cars and bicycles were elsewhere. I want to point out that the parking sort of helps everybody. Increase walking and bicycle trips through education, encouragement, enforcement, evaluation programs. We get rated every few years as a bicycle-friendly community. And we were rated at 4 or 5 years ago as bronze rating. And we asked, well, why don't you give us silver? We've done all this, you know, since you did this, we've done all these bike lanes and all these wonderful things. And one of the things they dissed us on is didn't think we did enough about bicycle education. Now, that's not my office's charge, so I'm not trying to pick it up, but we're trying to do some things. We obviously have Safety Village that Recreation Department does. Police Department had a grant for the last 2 years, I think it's running out, on ticketing pedestrians and cars who do bad things where they come together. And part of what they're doing isn't just giving a ticket, but they're trying to do education. You know, why did you go through that? You know, if they stop me when I jaywalk across New South Street, I'd say it's because the signal's 2 minutes and 5 seconds. That's too long to make you wait. So we're trying to sort of get more active in those things, and this just sends that message up. So that's the highlight.
So you're asking us, so this is a fluid document, or this is the summary statement, the vision statement, is the only hard statement in the whole thing? Everything else is to be determined, or how?
So the documents, no, the document's a hard document. Okay. You know, certainly all the goals, objectives, and strategies, the actions are going to be a little more fluid. Okay. But the things that we weren't clear about, we deliberately made vague. So saying that design for Main Street is an option, that's a hard statement, but we're not really saying what that means. We're saying we definitely want to look at that. When we hire an engineer for $20,000 to look at all Main Street, we're absolutely hand it over and say, here's an option to start with. But they may go away from it. So it sort of fits that whole piece. So the idea is this is a fixed document. We did this lots of public process. We had our bike ped committee was sort of steering it. But that it only really remains in effect in some ways for a year and a half. And then we come back during the comprehensive planning process next year.
When it gets lumped into the sustainable, okay.
Right.
So the goals, objectives, and strategies are hard. The actions are to be determined. And in a year and a half, it's all going to be reviewed as an entire, okay.
Which doesn't mean most won't survive. I'm not trying to say we throw it all out.
Right, right.
And even the actions, I don't think there's many actions. I'm sure there's some. But I think there's very few actions that are controversial. It's really more prioritizing. And they gave a point system for the priorities, but they are very, so there is a point system in there, but they are very clear. They have very limited information. So that's the part I think that's most advised. We have a point system, we start. Mm-hmm. You know, that's the point system I use for the transition plan, Complete Streets. But there'd be reasons to do something for that. So, you know, one clearly thing that makes us go out of order is somebody else is paying. MassDOT's paying, it may jump to the top of the list. Or you guys are issuing a permit for somebody, you know, and we're getting them. So that's why I wanted to go so far in the weeds, because that does help as you issue a permit for someone to think about what's there.
Right. Okay.
Wayne, this is perhaps a silly question at this point, but what is the thinking behind raised crosswalks?
So there's maybe two or three reasons for them. One is they work like speed bumps. So they slow down the speed of traffic. Now that said, these are major roads. So the approach and the descent are so gradual. We don't fire trucks to hit the bottom. They're so gradual, they won't really slow you down dramatically. They'll slow you down a little bit, but that's the benefit. Although frankly, that's the benefit for the second one. You know, the first one you hit really fast. But that's a partial benefit. Making the pedestrian 4 to 6 inches higher surprisingly increases the visibility. You know, when my 5-foot-tall daughter crosses, I like her being 5'5" for doing it. So that makes a difference. But then the other, which may actually most important, even though it sounds the most trivial, is it's symbolic. You know, we're trying to send a message. This is in some ways for cars. This is part of the sidewalk. Cars, you're a guest here. And that makes a big difference for cars. Now, we have to be really careful the other direction and not let the pedestrians know that, because we don't want the pedestrians to stroll out without looking. And so we're trying to deal with some of that. Certainly, you know, we have to still do the, my technical term is bumpity bumps, whatever those are called, the tactile warning systems. You know, and at the raised intersection we're doing on Pleasant, we're actually putting in granite blocks. We've taken off the bike path and moving in to sort of define the limit and create some of that piece. But yeah, so those three reasons.
Yeah, I just always, it seemed like if you hadn't already slowed down before you get to the, you know, it's not going to help the person in the crosswalk if you haven't already done something by the time you realize it's a raise. I mean, that was the part that I just, like, it's more, as you said, it's kind of a learned behavior kind of thing as well.
So the first, the other thing, remember, is these aren't done in unison. So Cambridge, when they started putting these things in, they put speed bumps in, and they found speed bumps were good for about 200 feet, and then people accelerated really fast. So you have to think about them in unison. So one of those we're doing on Pleasant Street that's probably even more effective is narrowing the street just at these tight points to 20 feet. It's 10 feet lane in each direction. Now, it doesn't work everywhere. We have to have a lot of truck turning. But right north of Holyoke Street and just, I forgot whether north or south of Short Street, we're going to 20 feet. By the building under construction and the depot, we have to be a little bit wider because of truck movement. But that may be as important.
For years, I've been puzzled by why Smith doesn't insist on better raised crosswalks. They're like, if you go to Amherst, Amherst College has beautiful ones, much nicer. They make these look like they're homemade.
Yeah, it's a good question.
Ones at Amherst have illumination, and they're much just more attractive and also more effective, it seems.
Yeah, I don't have an answer to that. They paid for the ones that are there already. And they did some. I think the one by College Lane is really effective. There's a two-block area. So they had a problem. This goes back to what you were saying. They had a problem with cars going too fast by the student center. Mm-hmm. Two students were killed there. And so they worked on the two intersections further northwest from that point. And it's not there's a lot of traffic at those intersections, but the idea was to slow traffic down. So they have a diverter island in one place, so the cars have to turn their wheel a little bit. That's the first one you hit. Then you have a raised one with another diverter island. And then I've got the sequence of which where this is in order, but just the speed warning sign, you're going too fast. And none of those are really about those intersections. They're about the one in front of it. But I agree. The only thing I can guess is Amherst College doesn't have that much frontage. Smith College has a lot of frontage, and we bug them for a lot of things. You know, we ask them to repaint the bike lane every year, which they do, we don't.
Oh, that's them?
That's them.
I didn't realize that.
That's what always happens just when the alumni.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
But we've asked them, I don't disagree at all, Alan, but the one I'm more worried about is by a Green Street and Forbes Library.
Yeah.
That's really wide, and we've encouraged them to do something there. So if it was up to us, we'd say fix that first and then go back to
Brian.
It. But you're right.
I know I at one point talked to Mount Holyoke because they have that kind of road frontage, and their maintenance people were very frustrated with the flashing lights in the road.
Oh,
gave them a lot of trouble.
We used to have that, and ours fell apart.
Yeah.
You know, and DPW still doesn't love the granite in the road there by College Lane. Settles at a different rate than the asphalt, and so snowplows do hit it originally. Oh. They probably would not allow that same thing now. And that was really contract error. They didn't do a good base of support there. But we looked at that for Pleasant Street. We looked at using a different material for the crosswalk. So in the end, we're doing some sort of pressed pavement and filling with a pattern. We're not doing a different material because DPW, for understandable reasons, was really worried about that differential thawing and freezing.
But what just like with the other example you're using a play. I mean, you're trying to create the awareness that you're in an area where this is important, especially important. I mean, it's always important, but that's especially important.
Right.
And by having multiple kind of a sequence of events.
And there's always a balance. I mean, I'll tell you the one which we're still in discussion with MassDOT. So Hockman Road goes to the sewer treatment plant, all the sludge trucks come out. But the bridge is only 11 or 12 feet high, so you don't get a lot of big trucks. MassDOT said they think we made the intersection a little bit too narrow because wheelbase truck 67 feet couldn't easily make without leaving their lane. They'd have to go into the left lane. We said, well, the bridge is only 11 feet high. We're not getting a lot of those bridges, and we designed for WB50. And we explained our data, this is just today, we explained our data and asking them, will you accept this? You know, because that makes a big difference. We were able to narrow the Hockman Road intersection by not a lot, 8 feet, but it feels like a big difference. Yeah. We might have to go back another 5 feet if they don't improve that piece. So.
Okay.
So I know you get mileage out of these plans by virtue of positioning yourself for grant money and state money and other things, but I think it's also a progressive thing to do to have this sort of comprehensive plan. It's for a town of our size, I'm really tickled that we have it.
Absolutely. I mean, and then just the timing, you know, for things like you said, we got funding on that one for Pleasant Street because we're the only one. We were just that much further ahead than other towns. So
it has to do with the comprehensive of the funding, right?
What's that?
It has to do with the comprehensive of the funding, right?
Yeah, right.
Then just bringing in action plans kind of is more. Mm-hmm. I think that's pretty cool, the way to do it.
Right.
Well, and those have matured in the last few years. I mean, the guidance coming out of Federal Highway is better. The urban planning guides are better. So I think you've got more to pick from.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Weaver, it's funny. You know, it wasn't that many years ago that we had battles with MassDOT when we wanted to add sidewalks or bike lanes to projects, and they didn't want it. They've gotten religion, and they're really in favor of them. And now we actually have battles the other direction, which is, you know, putting a bike lane in 6 feet wide on King Street eats up a lot of real estate. And I'm, you know, I'm second to no in terms of supporting biking, but I'm really fine with a 5 foot wide bike lane there. And there are places where we're 20 feet from the bike path, I'm fine with doing it. So, you know, it's sort of funny. I guess it's a pendulum swinging thing.
Well, the reason is because the state highway improvement programs now grade very heavily the vulnerable, you know, the projects that address vulnerable road users. So do I hear a motion?
I move acceptance, or I'm not sure.
Adoption.
Adoption of the Walk Bike Northampton plan, comprehensive plan.
Tess seconds. All in favor? Unanimous. Thank you.
Well done. That's
thank
great.
You
wore us down for an hour, Wayne.
I'm sorry.
We're going to
the adaptation plan you built upon.
You're right. So when we did the plan, we had a lot of things in the current comprehensive plan about climate mitigation, reducing our carbon footprint. And, you know, reducing our carbon footprint is great from a global standpoint, but obviously if Northampton uses no carbon, it doesn't affect the world. The climate adaptation is more, we know we're going to have more winters like this where we have frost thaws, which eats up the road, and we know we're going to have bigger storms. And so how do we adopt
discussing that? No, I don't think we should do that. I think we should maybe set an agenda date in the future to do it. She wants to be present. Okay.
You have a policy to just bring some more into that, right?
Yes, absolutely. It's the trade-off. You know, it's a lot of the adaptation stuff affects city infrastructure.
Good planning is
adaptation. Yeah, but some of the numbers are really big. I think that's the part that makes us, you know, if you walk down to the lumberyard, which just got funded, we just were talking about that piece, you're going to see 6 feet up in the wall where it says 1936 flood. We all say, couldn't happen. We built a dike system. Dike system was in theory for the 500-year flood. Dike system wasn't maintained until 2 years ago. And so it was certainly vulnerable. DPW with the new stormwater utility spent a lot of money fixing up the dike system. But we don't know if that's even, you know, is that the right flood, you know, with climate change now. And so you could imagine. So we have some of those big global things to figure out on, is our dike system sufficient to protect downtown? Are 1949 pumps sufficient? Because, you know, we have a river that flows into downtown. And then if it's flooded outside, the gravity won't go out of downtown. So we have pumps that pump out the water downtown. But they're installed in 1949. And so those are that's the reason it's a little more complicated, because it's all about our money. That's part.
Okay. Thank you, Wayne.
Thank you.
Thanks, Wayne.
We would like to, yours is more comprehensive than mine.
We have a couple more things.
Carolyn wants to talk about lot number 28, covenant release on 199 Emerson Way.
So I'm just going to show this map to you all. This is the Loop Road, this is Burt's Pit Road, this is Emerson Way. So they had done construction, sort of a three-phase construction of the road system, and the third phase was coming around here that they just finished, for the most part, except for the top course, over the fall, and they were putting in a water pump house. They came back for you for an amendment about that. That's almost completed. They still have a little over $100,000 in tri-party financial agreement, plus they have how many lots? About 10 lots under covenant as a part of the, also part of the performance guarantee. Part of that was because the lots that fronted this section of the road weren't even saleable because the road wasn't complete until last fall. Right. So they've done most of the construction they need for the infrastructure. They still have those 10 lots to show under covenant plus this $100,000. They're asking for release of just one of these lots. They're going to come back in another month or so and give a financial report of exactly what the cost is left to complete the construction, including the top course and some trees, and ask you for a greater reduction or a release of potentially all but, you know, two lots. Mm-hmm. But since they have a closing coming up on that one lot, they're asking for release of just one. And from our perspective, we feel like there's enough in collateral,
right,
to release one without seeing those detailed financial allocations for what's left.
Any questions?
No, it seems fine to me.
Okay. So moved.
Second.
John moves.
Okay.
Mark seconds. All in favor?
Okay. Can you sign that?
And minutes?
Yeah, I sent minutes. No, okay, we're not doing minutes. Sorry.
Anyway,
I was gonna vote. I was gonna move to approve them. we could have had one in the bank.
Yeah. No, it's on record. okay, and then the last thing is I sent around a memo yesterday or whatever. So, I think what would make sense, really, I just wanted to let you have some time to digest it, and then we could set maybe February 9th as a meeting date to sort of take that up as a specific agenda item. Peg Murray, who wrote the letter, really wants to participate in a conversation with the board, so if that works for you all, we can set that for February 9th.
Can I also ask, since that particular project revolved around water, we might ask someone from the DPW to come and explain to us how they review the drainage. And in other words, I'm as a committee, I feel like we're relying on their expertise.
Uh-huh.
And I would like for that to be publicly stated as to how they do that. I know that's a nighttime thing for someone to come. Or if you feel comfortable doing that, your explanation. But I think that belongs in that discussion.
Yeah.
Because I feel like once I've gotten a DPW sign-off, that's an expertise that I have a hard time challenging.
Did no, absolutely.
You mentioned here about something about a representative of that would be something here, a representative on the board. I was kind of,
she mentioned
a certain point here.
Yeah, there's some things that are not legally allowed. Yeah, so,
I brought that up because you brought.
Yeah, this is not my request on her behalf. This is my request
online. No, I understand. Just trying to make sure that that's something there.
Yeah, and I'm not, I mean, I will certainly, I think probably I can provide the differences, sort of their jurisdiction and what the actual ordinance says, which is, goes along with state. I can explain all of that.
Okay.
I can see if someone from DPW might be willing to come, but I'm not going to make any guarantees. And I, you know, it's one department to another. I don't know.
Right.
You know,
okay. Request so noted. Yeah. Thank you.
And that's all.
Move adjourn.
Second.
We're on a streak.
All in favor.
Yay.
Thank you all.
Carolyn, can I ask you a question?